Hello and welcome to That Atheist Show. I'm Preston, That Atheist Dude.
I am Koni, That Atheist Lady, and we are super excited to have somebody as awesome as Vincent on our show tonight. Everybody has seen something or multiple things that he has been involved with, and we are just going to talk to him about all of the things. So welcome, Vincent, and thank you for being with us.
Hi there, everybody.
So one of the biggest things that you've worked on is SpongeBob SquarePants, and we definitely want to go over what an atheist perspective is on working on something for kids, especially something on Nickelodeon that was so widely distributed throughout, you know, all of our childhoods. I think everybody has heard of SpongeBob SquarePants.
And at this point, I think so.
And so you say that you've worked on the comic book, and the comic book came out before the show. The comic book actually gave birth to the show. The comic book has existed now for 16 years. The show has existed for 15 then at that point. What is it like working on something that became a global phenomenon?
Well, it's unexpected, always. You know, you do things, you do projects that you hope will work out. And the creator, Steven Hillenburg, he's an interesting character. And I thought the whole series, the idea of the series was fantastic. And I was working for Nickelodeon before they called me in for SpongeBob. And I got to see the first shows unfinished with the prompter still. And I was laughing my head off.
Okay.
On Times Square.
This is what I really want to know. How did he come up to you with the idea of somebody who lives in a pineapple under the sea? What gave you the ability to say, let's do this?
Well, you know, he is a marine biologist teacher, so
okay.
It's in his domain.
That's awesome.
Apparently, this is something he had in mind for a while, actually. And SpongeBob used to be a round sponge. the first, it was the drawings were different at first.
Oh, wow.
And it's so the idea. I cannot tell you where the idea came in because it's his baby. But
of course,
all I know is that I was doing the Rugrats at the time, and when I saw the first episode of SpongeBob, I was like, yeah. This is silly. It's just fun, you know.
Absolutely.
The Zeitgeist at the time was a little bit more into shows that were educational. So,
you broke up a little bit there.
It was Dora. Was those things, and we thought, oh, did I? Should I repeat that?
You broke up for just a few seconds. You said that you were getting into to things like Dora because it was an educational time. That's where.
Yes, we were not sure it was going to work. You know, it was here we are in the an era where everything had to be educational, and here we come with SpongeBob.
Just like anti-educational.
It wasn't meant to make geniuses, you know.
Right, and that's beautiful though, because it just like the rainbow that he brings out. It's imagination. Everybody needs an imagination. It's a fun thing to have.
Yeah.
Exactly.
It was just fun. It was 100% fun. So
did he come to you with a storyboard though? Like he came to you with like a script written down. He's like, "Hey, this is my idea. Can you draw out some things, and then we'll see where to go from there." Is that how your relationship became involved in it?
No, he had everything pretty much pinned down.
Oh wow!
Everything was well established before I came in. In fact, the man in the whole Nickelodeon venture was Chris Duffy. Chris Duffy is the editor of Nickelodeon magazine, and now he's the editor of the comic book,
okay,
the SpongeBob comic book. We are great friends. I miss him because we used to walk in the park with our kids in Brooklyn, but now I live in Arizona, so you know we only have contact by computer and you know email and such.
Right.
But he's a genius. He is responsible for, in Nickelodeon, to have all these different styles. Some very artistic that had nothing to do with the traditional comic book style.
Mm-hmm.
And he's got a nose for I think, very artistic work. In fact, if you look at the SpongeBob comic book, you'll see SpongeBob in very different styles.
Yeah.
That's awesome. We would like to post some of those things on the page after the show. We'll definitely have some of that stuff posted. Connor, do you
have any? I'm not the only one with a SpongeBob for the comic. Obviously, there's a lot of work for a lot of... I think we are three main artists, if I understand well, for the traditional SpongeBob, the one that's on model, that looks like the TV show.
Mm-hmm.
That is my... that's my work. I'm a freelancer, so I've been doing... there was a time where I went from Batman to the Flintstones the same day.
Wow.
So it's a little bit hard sometimes to get out of one style and get into another. But for SpongeBob, I had time to develop, to follow the style. The style is really given by the animators. They're the ones who decide the evolution of SpongeBob. And if you look at the old episodes, he has changed. So I adapt to that. I change to adapt to that.
That's
awesome. But I have a little bit of leeway in the style. I can play around with it a little bit.
That is awesome.
It's a lot of fun.
Okay, and so a little bit before we started the show, we talked about how a lot of people take a lot of things from SpongeBob, even though SpongeBob itself isn't really trying to make a statement about anything. It's just silly goofiness, but people, either get butthurt or really excited about things that SpongeBob does.
Lots of controversy with the show.
Yeah, a lot of controversy comes out of this silly little show that isn't meant to be in any way serious.
Right.
And so, has there been anything that especially surprised you that people got, in an uproar over?
And an add-on to that, anything that you might have illustrated that might have influenced that?
Yes.
Well, there's a lot of controversy, and there's a lot of hate. I'll give you an example. I did a lot of the children's books that were from the SpongeBob series, and I would sign at Barnes & Noble, or I would go to a Comic-Con. But once in Barnes & Noble, there was a big line of people waiting to get their book signed. And so I was signing, and I was doing a little drawing here and there, and there was a mom that was with her two kids waiting in line, and I noticed her, but not more than anybody else, and she waited. When it was her turn to be in line, she didn't have a book, she didn't have anything, and she waited just to tell me how much she hated SpongeBob. She said it was bad for the children, and I could see the two kids were like, yeah, and the kids were like,
they're terrified.
I like SpongeBob, but I can't tell my mom, right? So, get slapped in the face here,
I have to watch it at my friend's house.
Yeah. So they were obviously embarrassed. But, I kept my cool. I just said, everybody has the right to hate a character. But I did say this. I said, I will say this, though, in defense for SpongeBob, is that you would be hard-pressed to find a character in the animation world that is so kind,
right,
naive, giving. He never has a bad bone in his body. He never tries to get away with something slimy, or he's not, he's just the nicest guy on the planet.
He actually points out the nasty people. He's like, hey, that guy's slimy.
Right. He's really a good guy.
Yeah.
I mean, he's naive. He's like a kid. He's actually a kid,
Yeah.
So I said, you'd be hard-pressed to find a character with such virtue as SpongeBob. And she went, and she did. And her kids were like, okay, mommy, we're following you.
Let's get out of here.
But, and people just cursed her out. I mean, everybody in line was like, she was called names, and I told people, hey, let her be, if she doesn't like it, she doesn't like it. At least she waited in line patiently to tell me how much she thought.
At least she didn't interrupt everyone else. Yeah, that's a good point.
Right. Yeah.
So, you take the good with the bad, and it amused me, really, to be honest with you.
I'm sure.
I can understand that some adults don't like it, because, if you listen to SpongeBob, it could be annoying if you're not watching the show, to hear it. Stuff like that.
Yeah, I admit there have been days that I have gone in there and been like, okay, that is enough fucking SpongeBob for now, guys.
Hillenburg and, you know, the creator, I mean, I'm sure at one point, you know, if the sound is loud and you're not watching the show, it could be very annoying, like every cartoon, actually.
Of course.
But SpongeBob is particularly loud. I don't blame people for not... But I don't care, you know. Now, when you're talking about how people take SpongeBob, everybody has a different take on him. Because he's so neutral, you know. He is a neutral character. He's a nice character. But there are episodes where, like, you don't really know what his sex is. You know, even though it's a given that it's a him, he's still a sponge. So the creators, they have fun a little bit with some stories. Like the one where he is... the daddy, or he's not the daddy. I think he's the mommy. And Patrick is
what
the
was
daddy.
It? Was it the oyster or something?
They brought up a clam or something. it's one of the old episodes, but it triggered a lot of controversy because first the gay community took SpongeBob at heart, which is great. I mean, you know, they used him a little bit as a mascot for a parade or something. I forget what it was.
That's awesome.
But in a very odd way, it gave a kick to the show, that controversy, and because it took a little while to take off, believe it or not.
I'm sure.
It was first a comic book, you know, but it wasn't... SpongeBob is not an animation from a comic book. The animation was already started when I started the comic book, and the comic book is after the animation. The main medium here is animation.
And it takes a lot longer to make the show anyway, right? So they had everything being prepared for that whole time, but your comic book was just boom, 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 coming out, right?
Right.
Okay.
It's faster. It's faster to, you know, to produce. Now, and I was working with Robert, who was also the penciler on the first story. And now I write and draw the SpongeBob stories for the comic book. I do it.
That's awesome. Now, I posted in a few groups asking for questions from our fans, just random stuff about characters that you might know about. One of the best questions I got, we didn't really get that many questions, I did it earlier this morning, but one of the questions was, is Patrick actually slow, or is he just high all the time? Was that like a background joke, like a little
he's
kicker?
Slow.
He's just slow. Okay.
He's just slow, man. See what I mean?
Now, one question that we thought up earlier is SpongeBob an... Would SpongeBob be inspired by an atheistic perspective, or would it be more Squidward, who's skeptical about everything? And he's always saying, "You naive bastard!"
It's funny because I'm pretty sure Hillenburg is an atheist. I'm pretty sure, but okay. For sure he does not want to use SpongeBob as a you know, any means of communication for his atheism.
Right.
I don't think that, you know. So
Squidward.
But you're right, Squidward. Squidward is actually my favorite character.
He's awesome
after SpongeBob, because he's the negative. You know, he's the complainer. He's also full of himself. He thinks he's great.
Yeah, the clarinet.
He's, less, oh yeah,
so
yeah.
Or, bad at the clarinet.
Or painting. He's a horrible painter.
He is.
So the show clearly does not want. To have any bias one way or another, but I think it's fair to say that the show is not pro religion. That's for sure.
Right, and so you think that you said that the creator you think is an atheist?
I'm pretty sure he is. I mean,
well, you
he's
said
a scientist,
he's a marine biologist. Yeah, exactly. So that's actually really interesting. I never knew that.
It doesn't mean that all scientists are
of course
atheists,
right?
But the good ones usually are.
Yeah, exactly. But I just never knew that the creator of a show like that was actually a marine biologist. That's really cool to know, because that's why he's able to incorporate so many realistic...
Right.
Well, not realistic,
opposite of realistic.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. He's like a marine biologist teacher that went crazy.
Yeah, he wanted to have fun with it, pretty much.
Yeah.
And things like Sandy that go under
guy.
There like an astronaut with a fishbowl on her head. You know? Like, that's just genius.
Yeah, right. Everything in SpongeBob... I remember when I started working on the series, I was like, wow, I wish I created this. I mean, it's everything is just so well thought of, you know, and I don't know, it was, like you say, it's absurd, but it's not crazy absurd. It's well done, you know?
It's very well done, yeah. How many writers are involved?
Ooh, there's quite a few. There's quite a few. If you put the animation in the animation, you have quite a few. I think the main guy, at least my mentor, and the main guy would be Sherm Cohen. He does also other characters. He also works for Phineas and Ferb and things like that.
Oh, that's awesome.
But he's an amazing storyboard artist, and he's a great storyteller. And he's a friend, and he's great. He introduced me to start doing storyboards for the show. But I will be honest, I kind of sucked at it because I've been doing... I was too... See, when you do storyboards for the show, you have to be very loose. You have to be very quick and loose. And I don't know if it's my age, but the more I age, the more I'm a little bit perfectionist on everything. So every line is really, you know... If you look at the comic book, you know, you read it in 2 minutes, you throw it away, you wrap banana peels in it, you know, whatever.
Right.
But I take a lot of time to do every little... If you take a time to look at the drawings closely, every line is reflected upon. And too much. I will admit that I'm too much of a perfectionist, and it slows down my work. So it's also financially stupid of me, but I can't help it.
But how often do you get a comic issue done and released, pretty much?
Well, I had a hiatus because of a triple bypass last year, exactly a year ago. So I've been very, it's been really choppy, my presence in the comic book. Otherwise, usually I'm in almost every issue. But for the past year, and of course, since the issues are created ahead of time, so now it's not always a guarantee that you'll have my work in it because of my heart issues. But right now I'm drawing, I drew a whole issue, so that's
awesome.
Going to be exciting. Yeah, I got to do that. I'm taking time to draw it too. I'm not finished. I just love doing, you know, I love those crafts, so.
That's awesome. I've always wondered about that whole detail thing of, like, when I see very, very fine detail in cartoons and stuff like that, I always wonder if that's because the artist involved is just, like, super perfectionist, or if he's just, like, been told to do that, or if he's been, like, paid to say, hey, make every single detail, you know? That's pretty awesome.
It could be either one. If you go on my Facebook page, check out the covers I did for Scooby-Doo. I was paid like every other cover artist. But I gave it all I could.
Scooby-Doo is amazing. That is like the coolest
and,
thing.
And if you look at the covers, if you, I invite people who, because my Facebook is open, you can check my my Scooby-Doo covers, and you'll see that I took a lot of time to do. Every cover was a piece of art for me. I treated it like a piece of art.
What years did you do for Scooby? You did the comics for
that's
Scooby,
a good
though,
question.
Right?
Yeah, I did the comics too, yeah. But I had especially fun doing the covers. Especially fun. I did that with a lot of glee. It was a lot of fun. But to check it out on Facebook, you'll see my covers.
Definitely. Scooby-Doo is one of my favorite artists.
Usually now, they're pretty flat now, but I took time to do the pop covers and stuff for this. It's a bit more complex.
How did you get in touch with Seth Andrews to work on Sacred Cows?
Well, Seth has a lot to do, amongst others, like, you know, Richard Dawkins and, you know, Amin Ra and Sam Harrison, those people, Hitchens. But I have to say that Seth, his show,
The
Thinking Atheist. Yeah, and his humor has always helped me a lot. Actually, he helped me to come out. He's one of those that helped me to come out.
Oh, wow.
As an atheist. As a fan, just as a fan. And so, and he has this wonderful voice that just, you know, it's like, oh, it's just, you know, I don't know if you guys are familiar with his show. But
yeah, he was in Christian radio before he became atheist.
He was.
So he has that radio man voice.
Everybody tells me I have a radio voice.
he's amazing. But he makes me laugh. I mean, I always thought his humor was, you know, was really pristine. And one day I sent him an email. And I said, you know, a fan thing from Facebook inbox. I said, you know, I'm a fan and everything. If you ever, I draw for SpongeBob. If you ever need an illustrator for anything, you know, please, I would be so happy to oblige. And one day he called me, and I did a few drawings for him, tryouts. And he tried out about 8 artists. And it just so happens that I think that we connected, you know. It seems like what I was drawing was, he says himself that it was like it came out of his head.
That's perfect.
Oh,
that's awesome. So we became friends. Yeah, we became friends. I admire the man enormously, and very thankful for what he did for my own, you know, my own journey. But when we did that book, I don't think there was a day we didn't start to laugh like crazy, man. We laughed so much.
That's awesome.
First of all, oh yeah, what he wrote made me laugh. I mean, really cry laughing. And I would draw, and then I would send it to him, and then he would be crying laughing, and we had such fun with that book. It's a very, it's an easy read. You know, I read it. You know what, you let it go for a little while, and you read it again, you know, a little bit fresh. And I was amazed how fun it was. And I'm very happy with my illustrations, which are done with my style. So, you know, if you can call it a style. So it's really me. When you look in the book, it's what I did was me. And then what really made me laugh was his idea of putting in the back cover. He put some quotes from, you know, pretty serious atheists there, and quotes about his book. And he made a quote that I never really did, but he says, "Can I say a bad word here or not?"
Yeah,
you can. I just said fuck a while ago. Remember?
I'm such a Taylor mouth that I didn't realize. He in the back cover, there's a quote from me that says, "Buy the book for the illustration, because Seth can't write for shit." So I never said that, but he had the idea of putting that in there.
That's funny.
I just laughed my head off.
So you said that he helped you on your journey to come out as an atheist. So how long have you been an out atheist?
That's a good question. I think I really started, you know, it's weird. I was brought up a Jehovah's Witness.
Oh, wow.
I was a minister for over 30 years. Yeah. You know, not an elder. I don't know if you're familiar with the Jehovah's Witnesses, but I was really into it. Not because I believed it all, but because I was good at it. I think a little idea, I have to say that I think there's a lot of people, ministers, Bible teachers, priests, that are in it because they're just good at it.
Yeah.
And you know, they get pat on the back. There was no money in it for me, of course, because Jehovah's Witness, you know, they don't give you anything for nothing. It was very hard for me to come out, because the problem with the religion, especially cults like the Jehovah's Witnesses, is that they shun you when you get out. There's no honorable way to get out, so, you know, it was tough. You know, it's tough to leave, because you leave a lifetime of investment, emotional, spiritual, intellectual, mm-hmm. and then you have all your peers, your family that are the same community, and so you lose all that, everything. So it's a very tough thing. I got into a depression because of that. But fortunately, my job and, you know, a lot of the friends that were in the Witnesses either followed me out or are still in, but are not shunning me.
So, oh, wow.
Yeah,
that's awesome. That's good.
So I'm trying to get back to the question.
So you said that you don't know, so you didn't, you were doing the whole minister thing, but you didn't really so much believe it. You were just good at it and you enjoyed the praise and like the attention that it got you. So like when did it click for you that, oh, maybe I should stop doing this since I don't believe it?
Well, it's very ironic. Of course, like many people, it was my deeper study of the Bible that got me to be an atheist.
Mm-hmm. I actually have it a Jehovah's Witness Bible right here.
Yeah, you have the new one? They have they're clever with their interpretation of the Bible. Sometimes they're right, but overall, you know, I was 12 when I thought this is not, it's not worth, this is not, can't be real. The deluge, you know, talking snake, talking donkeys, something's not right here.
Right.
And I asked my dad one day. My dad was a little bit tough. I love my dad. He was a great father. You know, he's dead now, but best friend. He was fantastic. But he was also very impulsive. And one day I got slapped in the face because I asked him, Dad, why are all the intelligent people, the scientists, you know, why are all the people who are really smart, why are they atheists? And he slapped me in the face.
What?
He said, because they're proud. They're too proud.
Wow. I mean, that's the thing about the religions. They build in fail safes to not listen to us.
Sure. And I was like, you know, the sun is created the day after it creates vegetation. What kind of science is that, you know?
Yeah, and how has there been day and night this whole time if there hasn't been a sun?
It's crazy because I would go as far as to say that you take the first chapter of the first book of the Bible, Genesis 1, chapter 1, you take just that, and you can debunk the whole Bible with that.
Yep.
Scientifically, reasonably,
they say that he says the earth was created first, but we know for a fact that the sun came first, and so it's like,
if there was a creator God, if there was a creator God, wouldn't you think that he would know that the first verse in the Bible wouldn't be, and then God created the heavens and the earth, it would be just God created the heavens. And in the heavens, there's a little speck called the earth. But that's all. There's no heavens in the earth. That's ridiculous.
Well, I mean, we just had an interaction with somebody about the stars announcement, or the Mars announcement. They came onto our page, our Atheist Show page, and they said, "Oh, what magnificent creativity." So I replied, "Creativity?" And they said, "Yes, of course. He put it here so that we can admire it and then begin to ask questions and start to discover on his dime." Like, basically, he's allowing us to question stuff at this point. And I replied with, "Well, your Bible actually mentions a firmament and the stars falling into the planet because they exist only in our atmosphere in the Bible. So what Bible are you reading?" Like, it's just like, it's crazy.
And she tried to dispute that and say that no, the Bible doesn't say that anywhere, blah 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 blah. And I'm like, no, it says that
it was really a shit show.
The more you know your Bible, the more you know your Bible. You know, I studied it with Hebrew and Greek concordances and you know, and dictionaries. I mean, I went deep. And my thing, my personal pet peeve, is ignoring context.
Yeah.
So for me, it is very important that you take any scripture in the Bible, you better know your context.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And I can assure you, and I defy anybody who listens to this to challenge me on this, I defy you to find a scripture that is scientifically correct if you take in consideration the context.
In real context.
It is a ridiculous book. It's ridiculous. I mean, Joshua makes the sun stop in the sky. Really?
It's crazy.
You know? It's crazy, but the thing is that, and I think Hitchens said it well, it's that the more ridiculous an idea is, the more it can be accepted, you know, and...
Yeah, wasn't it George Carlin said that you tell someone that the paint is wet and they have to touch it, but you tell them that there's an invisible man in the sky, and they just believe you.
And I think it comes from, I'm not a philosopher, although I do love to, I write a lot of philosophy, but I don't take any credit in being a philosopher. It's just that I love to think, and I love to write it down, and I love to write. So anybody who follows my blog, I don't have that blog anymore, but I used to blog a lot, but it was eating my time, and unfortunately, it would put me in the poorhouse if I continued. unless I do it professionally, which I do have a book in mind.
That's awesome.
It's a book not so much on atheism than it is on happiness. And so,
yeah, I've seen some of your posts about that. I was actually going to ask you about some of that.
What did you think?
Well, I was wanting you to just kind of explain to everybody your, kind of summarize your theory on the link between love and happiness.
Well, it's for me, it's self-evident that the more love you get and the more love you give, the more happy you are. It doesn't mean you can't be happy single without romantic love. It doesn't have to be romantic love. It could be just friend love. But I do think love is the most important element of our being. I really do.
I agree.
I'm going to write a book on it because it's so complex. I mean, I've studied a lot of, philosophy or books on the subject. I did my homework reading, Men Come from Mars and Women Come from Venus and stuff like that. I really believe that I've been corrected on one of my posts that you might have read, where a very close friend of mine told me that she says that you can love without loving yourself. And I kind of I'm on the fence on that. I think she's right. For her, for sure it's right. She's got circumstances that would prove me wrong in my blog. But I'm open to be corrected. In fact, the thing that I love the most in my life is to be corrected.
Mm-hmm, me too.
Because the more corrected you are, the more you get close to the truth. You know?
Yeah, I always
that's
say that
how
when,
we are.
When I'm wrong, that means I'm learning something. When I'm proven wrong, it
and
means
I'm
learning.
Yeah. And mind you, I'm 56 and I'm corrected by this young girl because she's young, she's still a teenager. But she made a lot of sense. She made a lot of sense. And we inboxed later and she's smart. And I'm going to take time to write that book because it's going to be very serious. I'm going to try to inject a little bit of light humor in it. But I do think there's a very important correlation between love. It doesn't have to be the love you get so only, but the love you give is very important. And I think we are doing ourselves harm when we don't love. I do. And like I said, it could be romantic and or not. You know, it could be the love you have for your dog.
Yeah.
I know people who are extremely happy alone with their dog. Extremely happy. But I'm putting it together. I love to look at things from afar, and look at the context again. I'm a big context person. So I'm taking a little bit what everybody says on that, and I'm going to write my own essay, basically, and hopefully it'll interest at least one or two people.
What I've read so far that you posted on your page, I found interesting, because you make some pretty good points that I hadn't really thought about. Because everybody tries to figure out, what is the link in happiness? Studies have been done that say that people get happier the more money that they have, up to, $70,000 a year. And then once you have more money than that, it doesn't really seem to make any difference. And that's why you have rich people that are miserable. It's they just have a plethora of money, but they're...
Yes.
Maybe why they're miserable is that they're just all alone with their money and they're not giving any love or receiving any love because they're just hoarding over their money. So.
I don't think that money brings happiness. I do think that the lack of money can bring terrible stress and unhappiness.
Yeah, definitely.
So there is a level where if you don't have enough money and you're stressed by, debt calls and stuff like that, it could ruin your life, and people commit suicide for that very reason. So I think the lack of money is definitely a vector in unhappiness. However, like you said very truly, the more money you have does not make you happier, and if that was the case, then there wouldn't be any tabloids. If fame and fortune was a given happiness, a sure thing for happiness, then there wouldn't be any tabloids.
Right.
So, but I do think that happiness is not a goal. I do think it's the path itself. I do think that if you think that if you win at the lottery, if you think that when you get this career or that career, and that when you will become rich, you will find happiness, you are sorely mistaken.
Yeah.
Yeah, because then that, you're going to be after something else.
Yeah. It's not a goal. Happiness is, exactly. Happiness has to be the path you choose. And it will have stumbling blocks. It will it'll trip once in a while. You might even go into deep depression once in a while. But as I have, but I think I feel happy. You see, I don't feel old. I'm 56. I've been through a lot of health issues. I have diabetes. I have a lot of stuff that are going wrong. And yet I'm happy. Why is that? Yeah. Why? I think I would have two answers. I was 5 years old when I wanted to be a cartoonist, and that's what I am. So that's one accomplishment that has been ongoing for 37 years. And the second thing I think was my now I don't have any more cognitive dissonance. It's my atheism. I have been so much happier as an atheist as I was as a believer.
It removes a lot of fear.
And to be naked in front of evidence, logic, and reason, to be able to say that you will change your mind if you are showing a better reason, a better argument or evidence, is wonderful.
You're absolutely not scared of your worldview being torn apart.
Now, that brings me to a question with Scooby-Doo, because Scooby-Doo is one of the greatest shows of all time for kids, especially because it shows the fact that when you seek evidence and you go past your beliefs and you come upon the truth, you'll find that the real monsters are humans all along, which is an amazing thing that Scooby-Doo has translated. And you said that you've done the comics for it, right?
Yes, I have.
And you've done a lot of them? Like, you've done extensive work on it?
Yes, a lot. I've worked on Scooby-Doo for 16 years.
So that's awesome. So what are the writers like involved with that? Is there a lot of atheism involved in that production as well? Would you say?
It just seems so skeptical. Like,
it's
such a skeptic.
It's a skeptic show. It's my first skeptic show.
It's funny you talk about Scooby-Doo because when I was a Jehovah's Witness, I expected a lot of people to tell me you can't do that comic book because it's about ghosts.
Within your thing, you mean?
Yeah, within the witnesses.
Within the temple, yeah.
Yeah, and I never got any flack for it for a certain reason. I'm kind of surprised.
It's a great show.
It is a great show. It's a great metaphor for reason. Critical thinking,
mm-hmm.
And like you say, the monsters are people.
Every time.
Boogeyman does not exist. And if
he does,
it's us. Yeah, it's us. Yeah.
it's so crazy. It's a good lesson for kids to learn at such a young age, completely, and to be involved with something like that is awesome. I wouldn't have ever imagined that somebody was involved with that was like religious and going around telling people to put this idea in there, that idea in there. Mm-hmm.
I think that their conscience alone would avoid them getting into Scooby-Doo, because it just goes against everything a believer should, you know. But then again, it's just entertainment, so people brush it off as such. You know?
And I grew up Catholic, and I still was allowed to watch it all the time, and I love that show because it was never like directly connected with anything like that ever.
Oh, you're lucky. You're lucky. My dad, he would. I wouldn't be. You know, in the 60s, there was a show called Shazam. I don't know if anybody remembers that.
I don't.
It wasn't Shazam, the superhero. It was the genie.
Right.
It was a Hanna-Barbera cartoon. And my dad would tell me not to watch it. I wasn't allowed to watch *Beauty and the Witch*. I was not allowed to watch, any shows that had anything to do with magic was totally banned.
Wow.
Well, yeah, I've been reading this book for research purposes, and it's about straight talk with your kids about sex. It's a religious book, but it talks about that, about protecting your children from secular television shows and secular music and secular media, because it actually like straight up mentions like Scooby-Doo and things of that nature. Like, don't let your kids watch those sort of things because it gives them a warped sense of sexuality.
Well, even if because you worked on Batman show. Also, right?
Yes.
Even Batman is incredibly investigative. Mm-hmm. Like, he's all about the evidence. He is a detective, literally.
He is. You know what DC Comics stands for?
No, I don't.
Detective Comics.
Ah. You know, I've seen that on so many comics, and I thought that it was only affiliated with Batman. Wasn't Batman, like, the original DC hero, or...?
Superman was the first one.
Superman was the first? Okay.
Yeah. Of the superheroes, you know.
Oh, yeah, because Batman still isn't even really technically a superhero. Yeah. He's just super intelligent and super rich.
Right. He doesn't have superpowers.
Right, he doesn't have actual powers, but that's what makes him my favorite.
Batman was my favorite one. Superman I always loved, and I also loved the Marvel characters. Spider-Man was a big one.
Spider-Man's huge, too, that's my favorite.
But, you know, comic books and sex has always been an issue, too. I mean, when I was a kid... I will be honest and be brutally honest here, but Betty and Veronica in the Archie comics were a big deal for me. it was big for me. I mean, it was, I totally discovered everything from Betty and Veronica. So, I should be ashamed to admit to that, but
Well, you were very sheltered. You weren't allowed to watch Shazam, so cartoon boobies were where it's at.
That's what happens to religious kids.
I can tell you precisely in 72, they started putting cleavage in
72. Cleavage.
Like that 72. Little line did it.
Oh yeah, that little line changed my life. Oh brother. Was I happy?
Yeah, but I mean, it's a real thing, though. That's a real thing.
You know, cartoons will. Comic books have the bad rep of, you know,
sexualizing.
Awaking sexuality in kids and demonism because of all the, you know, superpowers that are
magic.
Questionable. Being a comic book artist at first was a. It was a choice since I'm 5 years old because of the Flintstones. And ironically,
that's awesome.
I became one of the artists of the Flintstones.
That's awesome.
So I could die happy. Actually, last year I thought I was going to die. I never feared death. Even when I was a witness, I never feared, for some reason, I never feared death. Because I was always at a point in my life where I was happy. I was like, I did well.
That's awesome.
But I don't want to die. I want to live to be 500 years. But
of course,
that won't happen, unfortunately. And in my family, we all died young. So unfortunately, my cards are not the best. But I don't fear it, and I especially don't fear it since I feel that I've done everything I wanted to do in my life. Everything. The only thing I haven't done in my life that I wanted to do was skydiving.
I want to do that.
And now my health doesn't.
That's my day job. I work in skydiving drop zone.
Really? Really? I did not know that. It's a dream. I dream of it. I actually, when I go to sleep, I sometimes dream of, you know, I would love to do that flying squirrel thing. Oh, my gosh.
That would be awesome.
But, because I'm not afraid of heights, so it's something that I would love to do. But I can't do it for obvious reasons right now anymore. But that's the only thing I didn't accomplish. Otherwise, everything I wanted to do, I did.
That's awesome. Yeah. That's the perfect way to do it. And then, and how many of those things did you experience once you were atheist?
Did it open you up to be able to do more?
Oh, yes. I had my conscience.
Did you realize things that you didn't, that you wanted to do that you didn't know that you wanted to do before? Is that, would you say that?
Yeah. It might not sound very exciting, but writing is one of those things. I was always a writer. I've been a writer and an artist for 37 years now. But to be able to write openly about deep subjects that were totally taboo in my youth, and to be
Is what it's called, isn't it?
Kingdom Halls.
Yeah.
You can call them church. Some people call them temple. The
my
witnesses are
one.
Very, very. I don't like to hear the word church. It sounds so...
Yeah, my aunt was one. She used to always go to Hall.
And the Kingdom Hall. My mom and my sister are still Jehovah's Witnesses. Fortunately, they have not obeyed the
shunning.
They shun me. Yeah, because a lot of... even grandmothers who never saw their grandchildren because of the shunning thing. So,
wow.
So I'm lucky. My mom is reasonable. She's very Jehovah's Witness. And so is my sister. And we do fight sometimes. when the, I never started. I always say, let's not talk about this. But they want to say, but you know, Armageddon's very close. You know,
it's been close forever.
Since the beginning. That's why they wrote it. They were like, I think it's coming in a few
years. Their expression is, it's just around the corner.
Yeah, exactly.
It's been just around the corner since 1790, whatever.
Even before that.
It's crazy. Did you see my post on Facebook about the end of day people?
No.
Did you see that?
Yeah. Oh, this is a good time to bring up the picture of that you took of the moon, because a lot of people thought that that was going to be the end of days.
A lot of people weren't able to see the moon because of the clouds, and I was able to see it up to a point, and then the clouds came. But it was actually pretty awesome. Let's go ahead and pull that up.
I sat out with my kids in our front yard. We live out in the middle of nowhere, so there's very little light pollution and all that. Now, we sat out and watched it.
Well, Vince, what was this taken with? Because this is actually a really good picture. Got the stars in it and everything.
I've went on different sites, and some people have really the material they need to take really sharp pictures. I only have a Canon Rebel.
That is good quality for a Rebel.
But I do have a nice zoom on it. I got an extra zoom. But it's not a huge zoom. But the hardest thing was not to make it move, because at that distance, it just shakes all over and everything. So I put it on tripod, and still I had shaky pictures. So what I did is I put it on 10 seconds delay.
Nice.
So like that I could get away from the tripod, and by the time the 10 seconds were there, there was no more shaking.
Nice.
So I got a nice picture, and as you can see, you can even see stars on that picture.
Yeah, that's perfect. So now that we're on the subject of space, let's talk about the recent discovery, the recent announcement that NASA made. NASA on Monday morning announced that they have evidence, strong evidence, that there is water under certain conditions in Mars, meaning on a dry or on a warmer day, the saltine or the salt crystals on the top of the mountains will actually melt and then come down and bring streaks. Displayed here in these pictures, you can see like the darker streaks are actually the crystals melting and then flowing down the mountains, and this is only during certain conditions. I mean, this is this picture that I'm showing right now has a few filters built into it that are actually basically like monitored filters. They're kind of like what you would do with thermal imaging, so you could see something easier that you can't normally see with the naked eye. So that's why you see all these weird colors in this image, but it's beautiful. And then we have this other one here. It's kind of a black and white picture, but it's got the streaks coming down. This is evidence of freaking water on freaking Mars. It's amazing. It could mean anything. I mean, now we've just discovered something that nobody has ever known before us, for all of humanity. This is crazy.
And the wonderful thing is that it was predicted by science. It was predicted. I remember even in the 70s, they were talking about theorizing that there was even bacteria.
That it was just a possibility, at least. And now we have evidence suggesting that their calculations were correct.
You know, it boggles my mind, people like Ray Comfort and Cameron that say that there's no water in space. What are comets?
They're made of ice.
Exactly.
And what are you talking about? You know, it's like, they but you know, it's, I don't get frustrated a lot, but I do have to admit that my stress level, when I see Ray Comfort or Cameron, idiot kid there.
Or Ken Ham.
No, Kirk Ken Cameron. Ham.
Kirk Cameron, yeah.
Yeah, Kirk, yeah. Oh, Jesus.
I mean, so bad.
It is. Have you noticed lately I've been, I've discovered, I didn't even know that, I didn't believe that they existed, but I discovered the flat Earth.
Yeah, I've seen some of your posts. You've been trolling the flat earthers.
I found this out recently, too, that they were real.
You're like, my intent was not to troll.
I never troll, and I don't like trolls, but I have to say, they make you a troll. They turn you into a troll. Those stupid, idiot, uneducated, stupid people who believe in flat earth.
Yeah, I remember they like, you shared a thing, and they were like, The moon and the sun are showing in the sky at the same time today. That proves that the Earth is flat.
Well, we have a regular visitor on our page, That Atheist Show. All visitors out there, if you ever want to get some steam off and just fucking just go off on a creationist and just say whatever you want, feel free to join this guy, because this guy, Josiah, on our page, literally he's a young...
He loves...
No, he wants the attention. When he added me, he said on his own page, I had rejected his friendship at first by accident because I saw his YEC stuff and I was like, I don't even want this. And then I saw his post about me, and his post was saying that he found the most militant atheist that there ever was, and that he was going to jump on my page and convert all of my friends and do all this crazy shit. And he's like, I want the attention and all this stuff. So I'm like, if you want the attention, you can have the attention. But I had to block him from my page for being so annoying. So we let him come onto our page. He comes on about the 6,000 year old Earth, and he starts talking about the law of thermodynamics, and he starts just misunderstanding every single little thing. And then he gives me an article that says scientists don't understand the complexity of the smallest cell or something like that. And it never says anything other than they don't currently know, so there must be a God. And it's just like, come on.
These are scientists.
My favorite argument from creationists is to say, were you there?
Right.
When evolution
started? You weren't there either. Were you sitting there watching the bitches right there?
Well, exactly. Ken Ham says that the first hand witness is writer of the Bible.
Yeah, my favorite parts of the Bible are the parts where Jesus is off in the middle of the woods or something talking to himself. Somebody's writing it down.
Yeah, it's just like, it's crazy. They almost ask us to make fun of them for having such ridiculous beliefs.
But as much as I thought,
whenever we're like, wait, that doesn't make any sense, they're like, you're making fun of me. And it's like, no, dude, I'm just saying that this doesn't make any sense. It doesn't make sense.
But it's fantastic, because I thought creationists were crazy.
Then they are.
But when I saw the flat Earth people, I mean, these people, they should, I don't know, man. I mean,
they need to open a book. Open a book that's not the Bible. That's it.
They need to look at the horizon. That's all they need to do.
You guys, look, I take the plane often, right? And I don't agree that it looks like it's straight. I mean, when you're in a plane and you travel a lot like I do, you actually see the globe. There is a little bit of a, you know, it's almost...
The curvature.
That's how it was discovered in the first place, yeah.
Yeah, and you can see when you're on the plane, you can see the Earth revolve under you. I mean, it's like...
Yeah, as you move, you can, like, see more come up over the horizon. I saw on one of the things that you shared on your page, from what they said something about the perspective whatever, that the reason that you can't see across the ocean is because your perspective doesn't allow you to see that far. And I'm like, well, then how do we see the moon?
It's like,
but that is,
we don't have draw distance. This isn't a video game where we turn our draw distance up and down, you know? It's like, how do we see stars? Yeah. How do we see the moon if
we can only
see so far away? That doesn't make any sense. Yeah.
I told one of the guys, I said, you know, I'm an artist, and I'm also, my first job in my life was a land surveyor, topography. That was my job.
Right.
I said, I can assure you, the Earth is round, and your stupid, idiotic arguments deserve to be flushed down the toilet.
Yes.
You know, and I would add that once it's flushed down the toilet, it should be sprayed, you know, it should have some nice smelling spray, because it stinks of stupidity.
Now speaking...
What they do is they defecate false arguments that just are mind-blowing. Like, for example... you probably saw this guy that says, you see, the sun is very close to the planet. It's small and it's close to our planet because the rays of the sun, you know, kind of... And I'm like, do they know anything about perspective? What the fuck are they talking about, you know? So they got me really mad, and I turned into a troll. All of a sudden, you know, I'm a nice guy when I talk. Even when I'm with creationists, I stay calm and everything. But then with the flat earth creationists, I turn into a troll.
It's schooling, like, fuck this, guys. The same thing happens to me, though. I seriously go into a mode where I'm just like, fuck these guys. Fuck these guys.
Yeah. I try to be so nice and polite, and then they will say something, and I'm just like, Are you fucking kidding me right now? Like, well, are you serious?
The bad thing was I had one in person come up to me and say, where's the evidence for evolution? And I said, jokingly but seriously at the same time, go to a museum. And then he was on his way to a dentist appointment, but he stopped, turned around, came back to me, and then engaged in a conversation for about 20 minutes, citing Kent Hovind as one of the best men of the world. And I was just like right when he said that, I said, literally, I hate that man. I said that. I said, I hate that man. And he said, you would. And I was like, for a reason. Like, he's lying to you.
No, I mean, people really are... One part of me doesn't blame them because they're desperate.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I'm starting to see a pattern, and tell me what you think about this. And I don't want to be demeaning or act the superior or anything, but I'm seeing a pattern that the more emotionally...
invested?
No. The more emotionally challenged people are the ones that believe in this.
Yeah, absolutely.
I think that when you become an atheist, you become so stable in your emotions.
Mm-hmm.
And we always talk about IQ. There are people who have high IQ that are creationists, and they have higher IQ than I do. But IQ, but IQ is just one thing.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? I think that if you don't have an EQ that balances it out, you're fucked.
Yeah, and...
Emotional quotient. If your emotional state is not on par with your intellectual state, you're fucked.
What I've noticed is that, like, what the scientists of creation do is they are able to view the things in front of us, and they're able to analyze it correctly and view using the correct forms of science. But once you think about the past, they become encompassed in this view of love, to where God's love is the only thing that is the reason for all of us to exist. And then what happens is when we debate them online and things like that, and we're using logic and we're talking about things in a serious perspective, they don't feel that emotional part, so they completely dismiss all of it, and they're like, you're evil, and you're speaking to me as if you're
God.
Hateful.
You just hate God.
Exactly. And and they're saying you're being condescending, and you're like, I'm not really being condescending. I'm asking you stuff, and then I'm telling you why it doesn't make sense, and you're saying that I'm like being hateful towards you, but all I'm doing is not including love in every other word. If I was to say, oh, but love, oh, but I love you, then that's why I want you to know this, then they might be more susceptible, but that's so pointless. Like, to us, it's pointless.
Let me put on record this. I am an atheist, and my tendency is anti-theist, as Hitchens was. I am totally atheist. I am not an agnostic atheist. That is bullshit.
Yeah. The probability is too high.
However, where I am agnostic is I can't say there is no superior intelligence that you can call God in the universe. I can't say that because how could I know, right?
Mm-hmm.
So I don't know why. I can't say that it doesn't exist. But I can tell you this, and this is where people get sidetracked. I can, beyond reasonable doubt, prove that the gods of our traditional folklore culture are inexisting.
Yeah.
I can prove that Jehovah does not exist because he is clearly created in the image of man.
Exactly.
And not the other way around. Because he's jealous, he's a genocidal piece of shit, and he is he has no redeeming qualities. All he has as redeeming qualities is what it said in the Bible, that God is love. But it contradicts everything.
That he
does. If God was love, remember I said about Genesis 1, which is the first chapter?
Yeah.
Okay, listen to this. If you look at the original wording of when he created the animals, both wild beast and domestic. The word for wild beast clearly means carnivore. In fact, it's over 250 times in the Bible. That word, the original Hebrew word, is used to depict carnivores. So God created the cycle of life, like we know it, where animals kill each other for food.
Right.
If you were the creator of the universe with wisdom and love, would you have created the cycle of earth? The cycle of animal kingdom killing each other? No, you wouldn't.
I had a wife, a young earther, tell me that they were all vegetarians.
They weren't. They weren't. Clearly, they weren't.
I know. And I was
how about
just
saber tooth tiger?
Yeah.
I'm a vegetarian. Where's my caviar?
Yeah.
It's like, if you want to deny archaeology, we'll do so. And then the other argument I get a lot is that the Bible is geographically and historically true, to which I say, so what? I said, you take any book of Sherlock Holmes and you research archaeology, you research what London looked at that time, and you will see that the history is true, the background history is true, because it was written at a time where, you know...
It was realistic fiction.
The freaking train station that takes you to Hogwarts is real.
Right.
The train station that takes you there is real, and they have a thing there that says, in half quarters.
Right. So that's the thing. If you have historical proof that the book you're reading is true, so what? It doesn't mean the characters or the stories are true. It doesn't mean that donkeys talk. It doesn't mean that, you know, a hippie walks on water, you know. it means nothing of the sort. In fact, I've been studying a little bit what people say about the life of Jesus, and specifically, what's his name? Oh, I feel bad that I forget names. I'm great at faces, but I forget names. Kuei. You know, the guy who writes a lot about... I'm ashamed that I forget his name.
The historical Jesus?
Yeah, that he doesn't exist. Oh gosh,
I don't know.
I'm embarrassed to not know his name.
I've been watching Airmen, Bart Airmen.
Oh yeah. I've been watching lately a lot of Brian Greene's documentaries on quantum physics. The quantum physics is really something that I'm interested in, and like everybody, I don't understand it, but I do understand. What I do understand is mind blowing, and people don't realize that. I think that if we find a godlike intelligence out in the universe, I would say it's at a quantum level.
That seems obvious. Yeah, it's just that we're just not able to see that yet.
Right.
We're just not able to study it yet.
Exactly. Yeah, I think it would be at a quantum level. However, to use the word God would be really disingenuous, because it's such a loaded word.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I wouldn't use it. That's the only thing
God
I didn't like about
God includes a personal relationship to you.
Yeah,
the idea
yeah.
of theism.
See, a lot of people refer to Einstein as believing in God, and that was his big mistake, in my opinion.
That dude, one of the people that were talking about the whole Mars being a creative wonder, they did the whole Einstein equation, and that Einstein says that there's God.
No, God says God. When Einstein says God, he means the Spinoza God.
Exactly.
He means the God. He's not talking about a personal God. He didn't believe in a personal God.
Right.
But the problem that Einstein, to me, it was a mistake on his part to use the word God.
Well,
because if you're going to use the word God, you know,
then
people are going to interpret it wrong.
There was a letter that he wrote to a friend that said that a lot of people are taking that word from that definition that you're talking about and are falsely claiming that he, even though he publicly has announced that he does not follow any kind of personal relationship with a God or religion, that people are using that word to destroy his image. And he wrote to a friend, he's like, you know, this is really upsetting to me because I've constantly said that I don't believe, and then these theists are saying I do. Yeah, it's crazy. It's amazing. That for so long people still believe to this day that he was a freaking believer, and it's just like that was a lie.
but the thing I think what happened was that he hated atheists, and let's be honest, not all atheists are equal.
No,
some are just as crazy as some creationists, because they don't have they're not reasonable, and they do us more harm than good.
I would say.
I hate when I hear things like, "Well, yeah, you're stupid because you believe in God." I mean, that's come on, man. You know, if you don't have a better argument than that, then you know, get the hell out of here. You know.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
You're making us.
Yeah,
look
we're
bad.
Trying to be not to not go that route. We don't want to just sit around and talk about how dumb everybody is all the time.
Young Earth creationists, like, flat earthers are different.
Right. Well, they're the flat Earth people. I don't even want to say what I think I would do with them, but you know,
exactly.
It would be politically correct. But but no, they're really
crazy.
That's just crazy.
Yeah. Okay. Well, we're coming up on an hour now, and I think we should have you on again. I think it would be awesome to have you again some other time. It did go fast. Time flies when you're having fun.
Yeah. It's true.
So I think that we should end it with the statement that it is absolutely an okay thing to do to say that we do not know yet, and let's go find out. And that is something that a lot of religious people are terrified to say. They don't want to say they don't know. It's okay to not know. Totally fine to say you don't know. We don't know a lot of things.
But what we do know is that Sacred Cow is coming out soon, so everybody should check it out.
Yes.
When is it releasing? What's the release date?
It's already released.
Yeah, it's out. Yeah. It's out.
I didn't even know this.
I may plug the book. It's SethAndrews.com. .net.
Okay.
SethAndrews.net, and you can get the book from either, you know.
It's on Amazon.
Can I have the last word the last word, but can I have
please,
one? Someone?
Please.
There's my favorite phrase of all time is from Russell. Why I'm not
Bertrand
a Christian?
Bertrand Russell.
Yeah, Bertrand Russell. He says it's my favorite phrase. He says, "If a thing is true, you should believe it. If a thing is not true, you should not believe it." But if you can't find out if the thing is true or not, you suspend judgment. Period.
Always. About everything. Be a skeptic. If you're not a skeptic, you're being lied to most of the time.
And he
lying
said that
to yourself if you're not a skeptic.
I know.
He said that in 1959, the year I was born, by the way. He said that in the context of you can't want to believe something because it makes you feel good. It doesn't work that way.
Exactly.
Being dishonest to yourself is a very destructive character trait to have. You should always be honest with yourself.
I have his book, Principles of Mathematics. I have to get reading on that.
But yeah, we will definitely have Vincent on again in season two. We are all filled up, all lined up for season one.
Good.
So when we pick back up in season two for season two in January, we will definitely have Vincent back on
definitely
at some point.
Because I love what you guys do.
Thank you
so much.
Thank you.
Yeah, we definitely appreciate everybody who's embraced us. It's been a little bit overwhelming, but awesome at the same time.
We just never expected it.
No, we didn't, because we're going such a totally different direction than what everybody else is doing, and we're just kind of doing our own thing, and we didn't know if it was going to stick to the wall or not, and it has, so yay!
It's pretty crazy.
So thank you guys for watching. Visit our website, thatatheistshow.com. Like our Facebook page, thatatheistshow.
We're
on Twitter,
sure
is that
Sacred
we're everywhere
Cow.
Is that Atheist Show. And
make
yeah,
sure to
go
grab
buy
Sacred
the Sacred Cow.
Cow.
And
have
you a good
all
have night.
A great night.
And see you next week.
Have a good one, everybody.
Bye.